Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Wells, Minnesota. I am Pastor Meg Sander, and I serve alongside Pastor Mary Iverson, who is on vacation today. We are grateful that she was able to carve out some time to use up her vacation from last year. May she be refreshed and renewed. Once again, we welcome worshipers back inside our sanctuary. It is good to have you here. We continue to broadcast our worship here as well. A big thank you to everyone who makes our worship possible. Thanks to our camera technician, Brian Ellert, to Andy Grosskreutz, our worship assistant, to Gene Carlson, our pianist, to Marlene Kaufman, Sandy Hartman, John Melby, and Bill Grosskreutz Jr. Welcome back, Marlene. Good to have you here. We will be celebrating Holy Communion today. You can get your wine or juice ready and your Bible if you wish to follow along. We will be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. That's 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. Lucy's sister, Lois Johnson. Our prayers are with Eldo Overbo. Eldo is hospitalized in Rochester, being treated for a broken hip following his fall last week. We continue to pray for Gail Redig, the daughter of Barb Fox, who successfully received a bone marrow transplant from her sister. We hold her in our prayers as her sister's bone marrow grafts into Gail's body and brings healing and wholeness. Our prayers continue to be with Pastor James Scholey and his family as they grieve the death of Sylvia Scholey. The family will be broadcasting the memorial service on Zoom on Sunday, January 31st at 2:30 in the afternoon. Please contact Andy at the Good Shepherd Church office for the email address to request the Zoom invitation. 2 weeks from today, January 31st, at 10 a.m., we will have our annual congregational meeting following worship. Members can attend in person or on a special Facebook page we are creating for that day. It will be on Facebook, but not on the regular page. Please call the church for details about watching the annual meeting on Facebook Live. Next week, January 24th, we are holding a budget forum and a practice run for our annual meeting. It will be held here at 10 a.m. after worship, and people may gather here in person or on the special Facebook page. As we prepare for the annual meeting, please know that our annual report of the congregation will be distributed starting this Tuesday. It will be outside the elevator doors in a box located there. Please call the church office if you have any questions. I know that's a lot of information to hold, so please let us know. Our worship continues with All Are Welcome in the Red Book 641.
Children tell how hearts learn to forgive.
All are welcome in this place.
Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong and true.
Jesus.
Gracious God, you have fulfilled your word in the person of Jesus, your Son. Gather us together as your adopted family, that we may celebrate the wideness of your love and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our scripture story, the reading comes from Luke 4, verses 14 through 30. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread throughout all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came back to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things.' And there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Here ends the reading. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Creator, from Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit who continues to give us life, who calls us in and sends us out to share God's love with the world. Amen. Well, we've got the makings of a real blockbuster movie here. Our story for today is a real cliffhanger. Jesus has just returned to Galilee, filled with the power of the Spirit. Reports of his ministry spread throughout the country. Neighbors were talking to neighbors. "Yeah, did you hear about Jesus? Isn't that Joseph's boy? Oh, we're so excited for him. Isn't he the one who preaches and teaches, who heals and reaches out to the lost and needy?" There was definitely an air of excitement in the synagogue. But when Jesus reads the familiar text from Isaiah, a prophecy concerning the coming Messiah, the people were stunned. Because you see, Jesus claimed he was the one the scriptures were talking about. He is the Messiah sent for all people. Remember what he said? Today, the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Can you imagine what was going through the minds of the people of Nazareth when they heard those words? Perhaps it's like hearing the words, "You've just won $10 million." Don't you wish that was true? It catches you off guard. It takes time for the full implication to sink in. The shock is so great that it's impossible even to make a value judgment about the words that were just spoken and heard. Dispel our doubts. Jesus is here to give us the love and courage and strength we need to bear all things, to believe all things, to hope in all things, and to endure all things. Jesus is here, right there, right everywhere, to help us heal our broken world. But wait a minute. There seems to be a misunderstanding here. Jesus comes not just for people from his hometown or people that look like him or in a certain group. The Messiah comes for all people. Jesus comes filled with the Spirit to heal bodies, souls, and minds. He comes with bread to feed our hungry souls. He comes with water to wash us clean, so we can start out each day anew, refreshed by God's love and grace. It's more than a mulligan. It's more than a second chance. He gives us new life every day for the rest of our lives, for our whole lives. We don't have to keep track of who did what to who. We don't have to place ourselves above others or put anybody down. Who's number one doesn't matter anymore. It just doesn't matter. Because in Christ, we're all equal. We're all in this together. Maybe that's what scares us, because we've been so conditioned to believe that we don't matter unless we are number one. We don't matter unless we're the best, unless we're winning. But that's not true. My friends, we've got to stop that way of thinking and acting. Because with the light of Christ shining in us, we need to stop comparing ourselves to others, and work together to encourage and build up each other. We can do this. We can do this together because everyone matters to God. When God's love burst forth in Jesus, fulfilling the ancient promises, it arrived with power to heal and cleanse, to renew and uplift. The love that radiated from Jesus amazed all who witnessed it, but ultimately offended many. Because the love and grace of God refuses to shine dimly in rooms of our own construction. Light does overcome darkness, and love does win over hate. In our story, the Nazareans got angry because Jesus didn't put his hometown people first on his list. So they ran him out of town to throw him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went away. This scene foreshadows death and resurrection, oppression and narrow escape. which are the constant companions of all those who strive to follow Christ. We follow Christ by being a caring community who feeds the hungry, visits the sick, listens to those who have no voice. We follow Christ by being present with the lonely and forgiving those who have offended us. In other words, people who let the light of Christ shine forth in them and from them to the world. That's where our blockbuster movie takes a twist. The people of Nazareth were thinking they would reap some special benefit from their association with Joseph's son. Jesus was their very own Messiah, a local boy who made it big. Surely they would get something out of that relationship. If nothing else, they could turn the old carpenter's shop into a bed and breakfast. Or certainly they could charge for tours of Jesus' home and the synagogue. But Jesus is not a hometown boy who gives special treatment to those who claim him for their own. Jesus doesn't fall into their expectations of him, the one that expects him to take care of his own first, or that wants him to prove he is really all he says he is. Unfortunately, we humans are like that. We think we deserve special treatment, but there's more to the story. Jesus claims all people in all places in all times. Today's story reminds us that we cannot make Jesus our own personal icon. When we try to do so, we will be confused and angry when he refuses to be manipulated and slips away from our grasp. To know Jesus as Messiah is to be loved and forgiven and blessed and transformed by him. I know this may surprise you, but I haven't always been an angel. I knew sitting on my brother, my younger brother, wasn't appropriate. Or putting my sister's clothes in the shower and turning on the water, not good. Or throwing a can of corn at my older brother. I knew those weren't appropriate ways to handle anger. But my anger towards a church basement lady was hard to handle. I couldn't do anything right. I was constantly being scolded or blamed for things that happened. She wouldn't listen to anything I had to say. I put the silverware in the wrong drawer. I put them in there the wrong way. I brought rainbow Jell-O to a funeral. I know it ended up in the back of the refrigerator, but I went and got it and served it myself. I know, not the right thing to do. She was mad at what I said in my sermon. I didn't have proper discipline for the kids. I wasn't acting like a pastor. It seemed like everything I did irritated her. There was bitterness in my heart. And I figured the best thing for me to do was keep my mouth shut and stay away. But then she had a heart attack. I rushed to the hospital, praying the whole way that she would be okay. I sat beside her bed and continued to pray when she reached out and grabbed my hand. "Pastor Meg," she said, "I'm really glad you're here. I love you very much." Tears filled my eyes as I realized I had let my own frustrations and misjudgments get in the way of seeing her as a child of God. My friends, today we are led to a cliff. The cliff that looks down into the darkness of our own anger and doubts, our fears, and objections to how God is acting in the brokenness of our world. We don't need any special effects for the rescue, because God promises to be with us always and everywhere, to open our eyes to the needs all around us, to lift us up and illumine our way by the light of Christ. We can do this. We can do this together. And to that good news, we can all say amen.
Amen.
Our worship continues with "Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ." It's in the Red Book 674. Jesus calls us in and sends us out to share God's love with our world.
Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves of bone. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves of bone. Christ is able to make us one, at the table he sets the tone, teaching people to live to bless, love in word and in deed expressed. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves of bone. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves of bone. Jesus calls us in, sends us out, bearing fruit in a world of doubt, gives us love to tell, bread to share, God Emmanuel everywhere. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, loaves abound.
Let us confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Good Sunday morning. In the past thousands of years, the worship of God hasn't really changed too much. Our ancestors of faith would gather together to remember, to be restored, and to get strength for the days ahead. They would share the story, pray together, and make an offering to God when they worshiped. In this day and age, we continue to remember, pray, and when we worship together. In worship, we bring our concerns, we bring our worries, to be strengthened for the days ahead. And we bring our offerings so that the ministry of this church will continue to bring God's love to our community. Thank you for your faithful giving as we gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. You are able to make donations by visiting the Good Shepherd website and clicking online giving. You can also put your offering in the mail and send it to the church. And for those who are worshiping here in the building this morning, you are able to leave your offering in the basket by the door as you depart. Thank you for your faithful support of the ministry of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. Thank you.
To the poor and the oppressed, and to listen and learn from our neighbors. Bless our leaders with a vision of your future in which all are fed and welcomed. Shower the world with your love. Work in the lives of the lonely and anxious. Use us to wrap those who are hurting in mind or spirit with your comfort and care. Lord, in your Bill Harnick, who is awaiting procedures, Gail Redig, as she recovers from her bone marrow transplant, and Eldo Overbo, as he recovers from his surgery. Surround them with compassionate care and comforting love. We offer prayers of sympathy to James Scholey, Pastor James Scholey and family, at the loss of his wife, Sylvia Scholey, to Andy and Bill Grosskreutz and family, as they grieve the death of Andy's brother-in-law, John Flynn. We pray for the family and friends of Lois Johnson, Lucy Harnick's sister, who passed away. Hold them close in your comforting arms, O God, and remind us all of your everlasting promises. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Our service continues with Holy Communion. I invite you to join me in reading 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in direction. Your light shines into the darkness. You give bread that nourishes your people and frees us from our fear. Help us savor the meal that promises forgiveness and life everlasting." Praying together the prayer that our Lord first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I invite you to serve yourself or each other communion, saying, "Body of Christ, given for you. Blood of Christ, shed for you."
Thank you.
receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord continue to look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing song, our sending song, is Send Me, Lord, in the Red Book 809. Go in peace, filled with the Holy Spirit, to love and serve our Lord and all those in need. Thanks be to God.